Welcome to Sinfini TV. I'm Cyrus Meher-Homji, and on today's program, we have a gory fairy tale where the heroine is played by Renée Fleming. We peek into the 19th century drawing room for after-dinner mints with Rolando Villazón. Those who love their records and believe that the CD was dull in comparison will be pleased with the Sibelius vinyl revival. Anne-Sophie Mutter sidesteps the concert hall for the club. And the Peruvian tenor Juan Diego Flórez takes off for the Amalfi Coast for an Italian holiday. Vaga luna che in argenti queste ride questi fiori ed inspiri agli elementi il linguaggio When you think of bel canto, one of the things that immediately springs to mind are the great tragic operas of Donizetti and Bellini, Lucia di Lammermoor and Norma. But the style also brought forth miniatures, songs, from the pens of these great protagonists. They were intended for the drawing room, after-dinner musical mints, simply performed by the singer and pianist. Every family had them. But now, with Rolando Villazón, they enjoy a new lease of life, orchestrated for the first time.
Malinconia, ninfa gentile, la vita mia consacro a te. I piaceri chi tiene a bene, ai piaceri veri noto non è. Fonti e colline, chiesi agli dei, mudirò al fine, pago vivrò.
While searching for a new repertoire for recitals, I encountered these beautiful songs by operatic composers, Bellini, Rossini, Verdi, Donizetti, all of them, particularly the bel canto composers, did write many beautiful, beautiful songs. And I immediately realized how many beautiful jewels there were, like a treasure of the bel canto. Bellini is very ethereal, and the purity of the wonderful melodies expresses something of the soul that is floating in the air.
But bel canto is not all about sighs and tears. One of its earliest exponents was Rossini, who spent the latter part of his life in happy retirement. And one of his most popular songs captures all the hustle and bustle and enjoyment of life via la danza. The dance.
La danza. That's absolutely one of my favorite songs. I have sung it ever since I remember. When you hear this music, you simply feel that everything inside of you is dancing, is clapping, is full of life.
Già la luna in mezzo al mare, mamma mia, si salterà. Bella per danzare, chi è in amor non mancherà. Già la luna in mezzo al mare, mamma mia, si salterà. L'ora è bella per danzare, chi è in amor non mancherà. Già la luna in mezzo al mare, mamma mia, si salterà. Presto in danza, tondo a tondo, donne mie, venite qua. Un garzon bello ed ocondo a ciascuna toccherà. Finché il ciel brilla una stella e la luna splenderà. Il più bel con la più bella notte danzerà, mamma mia, già la luna in mezzo al mare, mamma mia, mamma mia, mamma mia, si salterà, frinche, 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 mamma mia, si salterà, frinche, 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 mamma mia, si salterà, la 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 la
There isn't a major concert hall around the world that Anne-Sophie Mutter hasn't appeared at. And she started early, appearing as a child prodigy with one of her greatest champions, Herbert von Karajan. Now she takes to the club scene. Yellow Lounge, the yellow being the color of the Deutsche Grammophon logo, was introduced first in Germany as an attempt to perform classical music in unexpected venues to attract new audiences. It's developed a real following in certain countries, and the age range of attendees is vast. One website I looked up suggested the ages of 15 to 99.
I'm never nervous, but I was very nervous before the first club evening because I would find an audience which I couldn't really be sure of the atmosphere and the reaction, and if my kind of music, which I love to bits, which I live with and live for, would really hit the core. Strangely enough, you know, it was an incredible evening and an amazing experience. The silence, the curiosity, the outburst of emotion, the kind of really wonderful party atmosphere afterwards gave me an incredible boost, a memory I treasure very highly. I also wanted to include my young musician colleagues, the Mutters Virtuosi, my band, so to speak, which is very international. We pretty much have musicians from around the world, and their age is from 14 to mid-20s. I think it also was a wonderful bridge to connect to an audience, and it also showed what wonderful bond music is able to create between different cultures and ages. And that's why we also included Vivaldi's Four Seasons, you know, excerpts of it, because it's one of the most colorful, one of the most timeless and emotionally driven pieces of music you could possibly play. And then with Lambert Orchis on the piano, you know, the wonderful American pianist, pieces by Gershwin just came totally natural. The next step was to select a program which would show, like a kaleidoscope, the violin in its best, in its many, you know, personalities as a fiddler. Many of the pieces we played were adapted for a violin and piano because they had been originally orchestra scores or scores for piano only. So with this program, which, you know, covers clair de lune and really all the facets, I think, of what music is about, we pretty much covered everything. I hope that we can enter a world and a surrounding and an understanding of classical music, which is permitting a much broader choice of music, and that we also will remove one or two etiquettes of, you know, this is good music and this is subculture, because there is no such thing. There is rotten classical music and there's rotten pop music, and there is great in both lives and in both languages, musical languages. Because it's so special, and special events in life, memorable moments, they are memorable and special because we are not experiencing them every day, every week. So yes, back to the club, but I will always treasure it as something very special and very rare. But I'm already looking forward to the next one.
It's cool.
I'm a self-confessed devotee of Renée Fleming. A radiant personality and that voice, a luxurious potion of cream and honey. Whether on the recital platform or in opera, she's divine. One of her signature roles is that of Rusalka, the water nymph immortalized by Dvořák in his opera. It's a fairy story, but not without its share of noir, and it's been one of Fleming's signature roles for the last 25 years. She recorded it with Sir Charles McCarris, and now revisits it for DVD with Piotr Bechsela in the role of the prince, impassioned in his singing. Yannick Nezet-Segay conducts, and the sumptuous production from the Met is directed by Otto Schenk. Old is new again. As we celebrate the 150th anniversary of Sibelius's birth this year, Decca has delved into its archive of one of the most prized of all Sibelius symphony recordings, those of Anthony Collins. And we visit Abbey Road Studios, where Sean McGee takes us through the process of remastering for LP.
Today we're cutting the Sibelius cycle of Anthony Collins and the LSO using the original tape. See, they're quite nice full reels, and the object of the exercise is to get music off these tapes and onto vinyl as cleanly and safely as possible. These tapes are in remarkably good condition. They played beautifully, and they also sounded fantastic as well, which is a great testament to the skill of the people who put the things together, recorded the sessions, and players, the engineers. Yeah, they were very well behaved. You know, it's just always a bit worrying when you have something of historical value and age, that when you get it out of the box, it's going to fall off the reel. And spend the next 2 hours of your life putting it back on again. But everything was great. It was nice to see. Takes me by surprise of how good it sounds. As being used to stereo, and a sort of massively wide audio stage, if you like. You expect mono to be small, congested, and kind of narrow, but it always surprises me with early recordings of how good and three-dimensional they sound for something that's not supposed to have these dimensions. There's a clarity there in these recordings, particularly where you actually feel like you're in the room with the orchestra, and you can hear them breathe, you know, shuffle about as musicians do. Mounted on the lathe here, we have a microscope, which enables us to look at the groove closely at the end of the cut to make sure there's no collisions with each deflection. The last thing in the world you want is for the grooves to, if you like, overlap each other. And the consequences of that would be, while playing it back, your needle would like to jump or become locked within there, and that's not allowed. They can touch, but they can't break each other's walls. If you see here, you can see the groove itself. These are the outer lines, and then there's the center line, which is the bottom of the groove. If you imagine it's like a triangle from above, and this the black in between is what we call the land, the space in between the grooves. And if one were to move the disc around, you can see they oscillate, and that's kind of the music. So we cut one lacquer for each side, and these are then boxed up and sent to the factory. And the factory then begins a rather torturous process. 4 or 5 stage process, I think. First of all, they silver the lacquers, and then with electrolysis, which is O-level chemistry, they grow a negative, and this is the fog. This is the exact inverse of the cut. So instead of having triangular furrows, you have triangular points. And then from this father, they then grow a mother. And then from the mother, then grow the stampers, which they refer to as children. They store the metalwork in together as families, which is what they refer to them as, which is quite quaint, really.
Being a bit of a foodie myself, I was watching a program about Italian food, and in particular from the Amalfi Coast, where it is said they grow the finest lemons. Well, this new recording, the Peruvian tenor Juan Diego Flórez's first celebration of popular Italian songs, is anything but a lemon. In fact, it's just gorgeous, but I did spot a lemon tree or two in there.
I grew up with the joyful sound of Caruso and Pavarotti's singing Italian melodies. I was fortunate enough to spend a lot of time in Italy during my career. I sang at La Scala and many other beautiful theaters, and also in Pesaro at the Rossini Opera Festival.
That, for me, is the sound of summer. When after a long winter, you can stretch your arms and look up into the sky and have the sun smile back at you. From the Amalfi Coast, this is Cyrus Meher-Homji on Sinfini TV.
These songs. I was so happy and had a lot of fun recording them.
they evoke sunshine, the sea, the beautiful breeze. I was really fortunate to be joined by wonderful musicians like Avia Vital playing the mandolin and Ksenia Sidorova, a beautiful accordion player.
Fantastic.